The newness is the topic of this part two. And just so you'll know, the topic of part three will be called the growth and or the growing. And I'm really excited about that. We'll probably spend about 5 years on that. I just get so excited about, you know, studying for it and learning about it, not being the one that has it all figured out. But there's, man, if there's anything in the Bible, there's learning and the opportunity to learn and the privilege of learning and then the resource. And we go on and on and on, and we will after next Sunday. Or starting next Sunday. But this, we're going to look at where we left off on page number 5 is where we left off, down towards the bottom of that page. You know, when we talk about this, this part 2 being entitled The Newness, as I've been thinking about this more and more, and if I'm not careful, I'll go back and I'll keep thinking about it. And as someone told me a while back when I began writing these lessons, it said, Rick, sooner or later, they got to be finished. You can't keep going back and going back and going back and going back. So for me, it's just to go back and to refresh what has already been studied. But the more I think about this, the more I am convinced that, you know, when we talk about this idea of newness, and God's all about newness. You know, you are a new creature in Christ when you get saved, 2 Corinthians chapter 5, verse 17. You are that. And when we think about the newness, I have thought about in the recent days, newness looks like something, doesn't it? I mean, there's no doubt about it. You can see it. And it's something that you can see. And it's not something that you can see because we're trying to draw attention to ourselves, but it is what it is. You know, some people say that your walk should match your talk. Thank you. We got one person on board there. Your walk should match your talk. And when we think about newness, newness looks like something. I remember as a kid, my mom, as I've said in the past, for part of our life growing up, she was a single mom. And then part of that life when she wasn't a single mom, she was kind of a single mom as well. You know, my dad wasn't, never met one father of the year or anything close to that. And that's unfortunate. But my mom raised us, and she did a really good job raising us. And when she did, she made about, and you know, I've been told, and I know it's true because I remember when I look back in my mind's eye, I look back at some of these circumstances that we were in when it came to money. My mom didn't make a lot of money when she was raising us. In fact, I think it was $1.35 an hour. And if she ever looks at this on the internet or looks at it on DVD, it's probably less than that. But it was about $1.35 an hour. She was raising 5 kids, and I remember going to the day old. I remember going to the bread store, loading us up in the car, and we were like my three. I'm the fourth child, and the first three were a year apart. I mean, that was just bang, 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 skip the year, bang, skip the year, bang. Me and my younger brother, and so most of the time we went somewhere, we all went, and I don't know how my mom ever did that, but she did, and she lived to talk about it. But we'd load up, we'd go to the bread store, and she would buy literally, you know, probably 5 or 6 grocery paper bags full of bread, and then she'd freeze them, and we'd eat that. We had plenty of chipped beef and gravy, and chipped beef and gravy is not certainly on the fine dining menu, at the average restaurant. And we had plenty of pigs in a blanket, and we had tons of spaghetti, you know, and most of the time at the end of the meal, when there was a little bit left, we'd pick a number for what was left, and we had a rule in our house. We had a rule in our house that, and I think it's a good rule. In fact, we adopted that rule. We didn't adopt all the rules that we have with your kids, that you ate everything on your plate before you got up. You know, and that's good because my mom, I knew why she did it. When I grew up, I knew why she did it because she worked hard for that food, and we're not going to throw it away. And she, so we did. We had to eat everything on the plate, but we wanted more than what was on the plate. 4 of us were boys. We wanted more than what everything was on the plate. So my mom grew up. You know, we grew up like that under that environment, and I'm thankful for it. But I do remember every once in a while getting something new. And for example, when we started school the next year, all of us boys got 2 new pair of pants, we got 2 shirts new, and we got a pair, if we needed, a brand new pair of tennis shoes. And those brand new pair of tennis shoes were like, you know, today, getting an Escalade. You know what I'm saying? And I'm not dogging the generation of today, but usually they get a new pair of tennis shoes when they're dirty. You know what I mean? Ours had to be flapping in the front. You know, the whole thing's coming around this way. And when you walk, it was like that. You know, and I mean, you at least had to have one flapper. You know what I mean? It's either flapping or your pinky toe is coming out one side or the other, and then you qualify, so to speak, to get you a new pair of shoes. But when I was growing up, and Ryan and I have had conversations about this, and he's heard this from me. When I was growing up, I don't know how long they were around, but they weren't around that long. And some of us old timers remember this, Converse. And Converse are back, you know what I mean? I mean, they never went out of business or anything like that. But if you had a pair of canvas high-top Converse, you were the man. I mean, you were straight up the man. And you had high waters on purpose so people could see them. And you know what high waters are? Okay. And so, and when you did, if you could catch yourself, if you could catch a glimpse of your reflection anywhere that you could see those Converse, you know, you would stop. You know, and it was just, it was the day that you wore them, everything, nothing else mattered, it seemed, at least it seemed, and everything mattered, but nothing else mattered but the fact that you had those Converse, and when you took them off the same day, most of you guys know this, girls, you did this with something, you probably did this with 30 things in one day, but when you took them off, you put them in one place, right by your room, and you just glance over at them, thinking what your foot used to look like in those Converse, you know? But, you know, days turn into weeks and weeks turn into months, and sooner or later, there were those Converse. That's obviously tangible things, but I would say this, that our Christian life should never do that. It shouldn't. I really believe with all my heart, if it's anybody's fault, it's our own, and we can only take the responsibility for ourselves. If there's not newness in my life, 30 years after I get saved, it's not God's fault. Mm-hmm. It's my fault. And I'm not saying that everybody's life ought to look like a brand new pair of Converse, but it wouldn't hurt. And when we think about the Christian life, the newness of it looks like something. I remember, and we're going to get into page 5 in a second, but I remember, and it talks about, when we talked about that in a just that illustration, that mundane illustration about, you know, material things, it looks like something spiritually. And I remember a guy named Drew. His first name was Drew. And Drew didn't really have a troubled life. He was around the place that me and a handful of my buddies used to hang around in this shopping center. Of all other names for a shopping center, it was called Paradise. Paradise Shopping Center. And we kind of became, that was our neighborhood location, so to speak, on Frederick Road in Catonsville, Maryland. And I remember there was a guy named Drew who was a little bit older than most of us. And Drew used that to his advantage. And Drew, if you looked at him on the street, or if he came by your house, or if he was around your family, he was very unassuming. You wouldn't look at him like somebody to be a threat. You wouldn't look at him like somebody that was imposing on the safety of your family or your reputation or anything like that. Drew was well-spoken. He was relatively clean-cut, but he was a drug dealer. And his clientele, I'm sure we're in more locations than one, but one of the locations was our location. And unfortunately, he did pretty well with regard to his business in that location. Well, at one time or another, during that time, nobody knew what happened to Drew, and unfortunately, nobody really cared. You know how that goes. We're so-and-so. I don't know, not heard anything, but nobody really has a burden for anything if something happened to him or anything like that. If something happened to them, you just hope it doesn't happen to you, especially if it has something to do with the law. Well, Drew disappeared, and I don't know the timeline. I'm not real good with timelines, but it had to be a matter of maybe a year, 2 years, and, you know, seasons, you know, one summer to the next or something like that when we were hanging out. And we were standing there looking at Frederick Road, which was about, you know, 3/4 of the length of this room to the park, to the road right there. And then it was kind of like shopping center where cars pulled up to it. And we're just hanging out there, and all of a sudden a church bus pulls up to that location, and the church bus pulls right up in front of us. The door swings open, and Drew is the driver, and he's going like this. And while he's going like this, he's going, "Come on, come on, come on." If you've been around MBW any length of time, I probably told this story about 5 times. The first thing that came to my mind, and I think it was basically unanimous: Drew stole a church bus in broad daylight. In broad daylight. And he's going, "Come on." So I don't know what you would have been thinking, but we were thinking, go. We're not in on this. We're not in the mood to get in a stolen church bus right now. It was like 3 o'clock in the afternoon or whatever it was. And he's waving us over. We said no. And he said, come on. And somebody, I don't know who it was, said, what? Like, to what? And he said, camp meeting. That's what he said. Now, I know what a camp meeting is today, but I had no idea what a camp meeting was that day. And so I and a couple other people, I remember it distinctly, just went, go. Get out of here. And he did. And he left. And I think I was about 19 years old. I wasn't 20, but I was about 18, 19 years old that afternoon. And then fast forward about 10 years. And Vicki and I are standing in a church service. We had just gotten saved. I'm talking, when I say just gotten saved, months. 2 months, maybe 3 months. And I glanced over, and this church service was about, the attendance was probably about 600 or 700 people. And I glanced over, we were in the back to the right, which we were there for a long time, the back to the right. And I looked over to the front, to my right, and I looked over and I thought, that's Drew. And when I looked over, I was caught up so much in the moment, because all that just came full circle. Because I didn't know what Drew was doing 10 years ago, but when I saw him and I knew that that's who it was, it connected. And had I had that 10 years back, and I can't do anything about it, I couldn't do anything about it, but had I got on that bus, I don't know what would happen. I don't know what would happen. I may have turned down Jesus. I'm sure I would have had an opportunity to get saved. But I turned down the opportunity to go. And when I saw him, I was just overwhelmed with emotion. And I was overwhelmed with what could have been. But I was more overwhelmed on what was. Not in the past, but what was going on right then and now. I knew that Drew was trying to make a difference in the life of some of the young men, is what we were, if we could be called anything, some of the young men that I don't think it was a part that he tried to go and say, I've done a lot of bad things and I'm going to try to make up for it. Maybe that was part of it. But whatever the motive was, it was a good one. Whatever the objective was, it was a right one. And when I looked over, that was the beginning of the church service. And my mind the whole time, I have no idea what a lot of people have preached, unfortunately, but I do know this, I have no idea what was preached that day, because all I wanted to do was get to Drew and say thank you. And I did. I had that opportunity. And when I walked up to him, I could hardly talk. And I said, you don't remember me, do you? He said, well, you look familiar. Now, when you walk up to a drug dealer, a former drug dealer, and say, you don't remember me, do you? He's definitely not going to come out right away and say, you remember me, you know what I mean? You're going to find out who's asking the questions. I mean, that usually doesn't change. But I said, you don't remember me, do you? And he said, your name looks familiar. I mean, your face looks familiar. And I said, I told him my name. He said, oh, yeah. And I said, man, you may not remember this. I said, but I remember it like it was yesterday, that you came up to Paradise Shopping Center on a church bus and tried to get a bunch of us, and I named a couple of other names, tried to get a bunch of us to come to a camp meeting. And I said, none of us went. We just waved you on. And I said, I wish I would have got on the bus. I don't know what would have happened, but I got saved. And I totally understand. I totally understand what you were trying to do. Thank you. And I don't know what that meant to him, but it meant a lot to me. And this is what it means to me today, that I saw a difference in the life of Drew. And as a lost person, I really couldn't make the connection, but there was something there that was different. And as a saved person, I was able to thank God by the leadership of the Holy Spirit and a realness of a real experience with Christ, I was able to make that connection. And my question is, for a long introduction, but my question is, do people make that connection with us? Do they make that connection with us? In other words, I'm not talking about everybody that knew you from the past. Do they make that connection? More than likely, they do make some kind of a connection. But I can tell you this, everybody from the past eventually ought to be able to make that connection, at least generally speaking. They ought to look at us perhaps from a distance and even close up based on a conversation or a situation and say, that person's a little bit different. I might not be able to make the connection when it comes to truth and be able to identify what's going on, but I can see a difference in that person's life. And certainly, progressively and gradually, no doubt about it, everybody ought to see the difference in our lives. And when they do, it's not us. It's the reflection of what we're talking about today. It's a reflection of the newness. It's not trying to be convincing. It's not trying to be, just trying to talk somebody into making a decision that we made. It's a real, authentic reality of the difference that Jesus Christ has made in a person's life. And I say this, that you don't really have to do that. In other words, it ought to be an overflow. We're going to talk about that in a minute. It shouldn't be something that we have to force. It should be just happening. It should be as natural to us as a believer in Jesus Christ, if you are one, as it was naturally to act like a lost person. It should be that natural, and it should just be the overflow of Christ and the activity of God in our life. And when we look at these verses that we read for the last couple of weeks in Psalm chapter 40, in the 40th Psalm in verse 1, 2, and 3, David said, and we've already gone through this, we're going to look at the B part of verse 3 today. He said, I waited patiently for the Lord. He inclined unto me and heard my cry, brought me up also out of a horrible pit, out of the miry clay, set my feet upon a rock, and established my goings. Verse 3 says, he put a new song in my mouth, even praise unto our God. And then this B part of verse 3, the last part of it, says this, many shall what?
See
it, and fear, and trust in the Lord. Now go ahead and fast forward, because we looked at the first two things, David's position, where we talked about how David waited patiently for the Lord. We looked at God's response, where God inclined unto him, or he heard him, and he heard his cry, brought him up out of a horrible pit, out of the miry clay, set his feet upon a rock, and established his goings. And then, as you look down at the bottom of page 5, we see what I would describe as the observer's blessing. You know, we should be a blessing to people. We really should. You know, and I'm not saying that everybody, especially me, is getting an A+, and it's not time for you to amen right now. But I'm not saying that everybody's getting an A+ in this, but you should be. We should be gradually, consistently, we should be a blessing to people. And David talked about that, what that looked like, and when it says, many shall see it and fear and trust in the Lord. Right down at the bottom of page 5, the result of the overflow of our lives will be the blessing for others. It is not possible for anyone to live Christ, listen, and others not see Christ in them. Our greatest witness is a changed life. Many will see it, the Bible says, and fear. Not fear us, but fear the Lord who is in us. And this is not necessarily a trembling fear. Now there are places in the Word of God where it talks about that, but it is commonly understood as, and in this context of this verse, as a reverence for God. You know, as a holy reverence for God, which is translated, so to speak, as a fear of God. Now, I will stand here today and tell you I am afraid of God. You know, I'm not saying that that's the only reaction, the only thought that comes to my mind when I think about God. It's not just, you know, I think God's ready to pounce on me every time I make a mistake, every time I sin against Him. I'm not talking about that. But a fear of God is a respect for God, a reverence for God. It's an understanding that, if you want to say it like this, God don't play. You know what I mean? Amen. But He loves us. And the attribute of God is always consistent with His love. Every other attribute of God is always consistent with His love. His discipline is always rooted in His love. His compassion is always rooted in His love. We can go on and on with all the attributes of God. It's always rooted in the fact that God is, the Bible says, God is what? He is love. And so it shouldn't, your life and my life should not reflect Christ in a way that makes people afraid. And unfortunately, some people, and I'm not saying I'm no better than these folks, but I've heard it this way, where all you hear is be afraid. All you hear is God's going to get you. All you hear is if you don't become more like this and this and this and this and this, and before you know it, you're not, your Christian life is not a reflection of what you're for, it's a reflection of what you're against that makes you more spiritual. And that's not the case. You know, when you think about the Christian life, and the term is legalism. Legalism says, unfortunately, that the more things I'm against, the more spiritual it makes me look. In other words, if everybody's not, it kind of promotes a cookie-cutter Christianity. If everybody doesn't think like me, look like me, act like me, then they must not be right with God. Well, there's many days that I'm glad that people don't think like me, look like me, and act like me. You know what I mean? And by the way, we're not trying to get people to do that. I need to think like, act like, look like Christ. And so, spiritually speaking, when we think about this, when we think about it, it looks like something, and if we're not careful, we will promote some type of cookie-cutter Christianity. We're to reflect Christ in our lives. We're not, our greatest witness is a changed life. Many will see it in fear. Not fear the Lord, but fear the Lord who is in us. Never underestimate your ability to make a difference in the lives of others based on the difference that God has made in you. We are not simply to absorb the light of Christ in our lives. We are to reflect it. And I'll tell you what, do not neglect the Christian growth in your life. Because sometimes I've seen it, and I'm sure I've probably been a part of it. Doesn't make us a terrible person. I think a lot of it is manifestation of ignorance, spiritual ignorance. But trying to be convincing to everybody around us that we've changed. What do you got to convince anybody that you've changed if you're changing? You know what I'm saying? And I don't say that in an arrogant way, but the bottom line is it'll look like something when you let that happen. You know, people see a difference in you when you let that happen. Let me give you an example quickly. In Matthew chapter 15 and verse 30 and 31, great multitudes, the Bible says, came unto him, came to Jesus, having with them those that were lame, blind, dumb, maimed, and many others, and cast them down at Jesus' feet, and he healed them, insomuch that the multitude wondered. And that word wonder means they marveled, they were amazed. In other words, it takes the word wonder, as we know it, to kind of another level. When they saw the dumb to speak, the maimed to be whole, the lame to walk, and the blind to see, and what happened? They glorified God. And see, that is the overflow. That's the reflection of Christ doing a work in someone's lives. And obviously, this is a great number of people he was doing that. In other words, they didn't just look at the people and go, "Oh, man, I'll tell you what, man, look at Matt. Look at Matt go. See Matt run. See Matt run to Jesus. See Matt run to Jesus and Jesus do something." You know, it's not all about the focus. It's not all about, and I'm not trying to put the spotlight on Matt, but the bottom line, the focus is not on the people. The focus is a reflection of what happened to the people, and they were looking to Christ, and the Bible says they glorified God when they saw that. So this is a living example of what we're talking about, and again, a living example of what David was talking about in Psalm 40. In Matthew chapter 15, we see people being brought to Jesus with various needs. We can be sure that each of them had tried various ways to have their needs met. The lame, the blind, the dumb, the maimed, and many others were brought to Jesus. It mattered not to Jesus what the condition was. All that matters is that they came to him. You ever notice that in the Word of God? Following through Matthew, Mark, Luke, and John, you'll never ever see a case that came to Jesus and he was either baffled or he was put to the test. You know, and he didn't ask for details. How'd you get that way? Now, every once in a while, one time, in fact, at the pool of Bethesda, when he followed the guy or went to the temple and saw the guy that he had healed on those five porches, on one of those porches, and he said, "Go and sin no more, lest the worst thing come upon you." Obviously, referring to the fact that his sin is what led him to the pool, or was the cause of his condition. But you never see Jesus asking for details. And then the result of the answer for the details was whether or not he was going to help him. Anybody wanting to be helped by Jesus then and today is just by their own willingness to be helped. By their own just letting down their guard, opening up their will to the will of Christ and him being active in their lives. And you see it in the same way. Several things that we see in this example. The needs were great and the needs were many. Wherever we find people, we will find needs. There might be some who have greater needs than others, but there will never be anyone with no needs at all. Anybody in here doesn't have any needs? You're free to go. Okay? Everybody's got needs. So you want mine? You can have mine. Okay? One of the most beautiful pictures in this story, and if you didn't see it, I didn't see it at first, and I didn't see it probably, if I've read this story 50 times or 100 times, I didn't see it until studying for it. One of the most beautiful pictures in this story is described by the following: "And great multitudes came unto him, having with them." In other words, people brought people. It wasn't just everybody, you know, kind of like, you know, well, me and my buddy are going, or me and my family are going. It says, "Great multitudes came unto him, having with them," and we would not certainly be changing the text at all. We could say having brought with them. You know, and so perhaps we can be confident in saying that the ones who appeared to have the greatest needs were brought by the ones who appeared to have fewer needs. Isn't that the way it's supposed to happen? Really, I mean, seriously, sooner or later, we need to get to the place. And I'm not trying to push anyone in the room to the place, okay? You know, it's, the focus of the Christian life is focus on God because God's focused on us. But sooner or later, we need to start focusing on others. When we start getting some relief, spiritually speaking, you want to say physically speaking, financially speaking, however you want to describe it, but most importantly, spiritually speaking, there ought to come a time when we start to turn that corner, where we're getting a little bit stronger, we're getting a little bit wiser, we're learning from the past, and we're finding out that our new life in Christ, that our responsibility is to give it away. It's to be a reflection of what God's done in our lives. And folks, that is not necessarily a title or a ministry. It could be a ministry of your own, but it doesn't have to be called anything. It should be called, if it's called anything, available. That's what it should be called, spiritually speaking, okay? It should be called available. So I am available to be a blessing to someone else, and I really think that's what was going on here. Look at Psalm 70, verse 5. The Bible says, "But I am poor and needy. Make haste unto me, O God. Thou art my helper, my deliverer. O Lord, make no tarrying or don't wait." This is what he said in Psalm 72, verse 12. "For he has delivered the needy when he cries, the poor also, and him that has no helper." God's about deliverance. You see the word deliverance. In fact, the word salvation means deliverance. You know, God's all about that. But he's not just about that in order that, you know, you and I just get on our merry way. And I think that anybody, if you want to use the word recovery, I like to use the word discipleship, but and sanctification. But if anybody that's in this area of life where God has begun to and continues to putting it back together, and then if I've seen anybody make the mistakes, and by the way, I made it myself, that you just get well enough to get on with your life and forget whatever happened to get you there. Because I've always said, whatever got you there is what will keep you there. And just continue the journey of the Christian life. The Bible, in no place, you can find it from the table of contents to the maps, says anything about the Christian life and a disciple and follower of Jesus Christ that lets up, sits down, lays down, and quits once they got so spiritually mature that they can get on with their life. There's nowhere, no instruction, no principle, nothing in the Word of God that says that. The Christian life is a journey from the time that I get saved to the time I step on heaven's shore, and then another journey begins for eternity. And so when we think about this, when we look about this, the needs were great, the needs were many, but there were people who were being part of, so to speak, a link in the chain for others whose needs were greater. And so if that is something that you want to take up as a responsibility, I would encourage you to do that. The needs were not only great, the needs were many, but the needs were met. And many saw it. Insomuch that they wondered or marveled and amazed when they saw. In other words, you know, that obviously reinforces the fact that it looks like something. Change is real. Change looks like something. Whether it's good or bad, it always looks like something. As you begin to grow in a Christian life, the newness of your life will be a testimony in the lives of others. Hope is always birthed in the life of a person when they see someone else overcoming the things that they are struggling with. And here's what we can learn from that. I never want, and I hope I can speak for the room, I never want people to be amazed at the change in my life. And by the way, don't be amazed at the change in my life, because there's more change to come. You know, I need to change some more. But I would love for them to be amazed by God who has produced that change. Any time that we take credit for the change, we are carelessly drawing attention to ourselves. And any person that draws attention to themselves is an obstacle to Jesus Christ. The newness will only be more of the oldness if we try to take credit for it. You know, when I think of clean time, I think of this. Clean time is an amazing thing. On Wednesday nights, we give out tokens for Lent of Sobriety for 30 days and 60 and 90 and 6 months, 9 months, and 1 year. We make a big deal of it. I don't know if y'all can hear us over there, yes, you ladies that are in there, and we make a big deal of it. And that's a double insulated wall all the way up to the ceiling. We're serious about confidentiality. And no joke, if you want to try to run through it, go ahead. Anybody wants to? All right. But I can tell you what, we make a big deal out of that because it's a big deal. It really is a big deal. But the big deal is that person, by and large, the majority of them, have cooperated with the will of God in their lives during that period of time. And I look at it like, you know, that is a reflection of the power of God in a person's life. Yeah. In most cases, I'm not talking about in every case. There's people that have gotten clean and stayed that way without God. But I cannot speak for the person who's had a changed life, because Jesus changes lives. Yeah. And so, in other words, you know, we're applauding, but we're applauding their accomplishment and what God, most importantly, has done in their life. And that's really what it all boils down to. Two Saturdays ago, and I've said this before, is the only time I know it is when the Preakness Horse Race comes around each year. That's the last time I did anything. That was the last time I relapsed, if you want to call it that. And I just get reminded. I don't even know the date, but I get reminded every time the year rolls around. It was 28 years ago. This couple Saturdays ago. And I'm going to tell you what, there's nothing in me, not because I'm humble, not because I'm smart, not because I'm wise, not because of anything. There's nothing in me that wants to say anything but thank you, God. You know what I mean? Like, man, I'm thankful you got me a good brain and everything like that. You made me so intelligent. I'm smart enough to stay clean on my own. I'm really not, okay? Sorry to disappoint you, but I'm dumb enough to relapse any day. But the bottom line is, it's the difference that Christ makes in a person's life. And that's what we look, and that's what we praise. Look at the other example quickly. And immediately, in Luke chapter 18, this is just, you know, just more evidence, so to speak, of a reflection of that newness. And immediately he received his sight, followed him, glorified God, and all the people, when they saw it, did what again? Gave praise unto God. Many saw it, and they glorified God. When they saw the dumb speak, and the maimed to walk, the maimed to be made whole, the lame to walk, the blind to see, and they glorified the God of Israel. Notice what they saw, the dumb to speak, the maimed to be made whole, the lame to walk, and the blind to see. They saw the people that experienced the change. No doubt they could see the Lord, and they did, and the Bible could have described it the same way, but for some reason the Lord wanted us to know that when people see people who have been changed, they glorify God. Would to God each of us might have the same experience, that others might see and glorify the Lord because of what they have seen. Not perfection, not superiority, and certainly not better than anyone else. Just a noticeable, consistent change that speaks to the fruit of the humble, grateful follower of Jesus Christ. This newness and what it looks like is best described by Jesus. Matthew chapter 5 and verse 16. We read this every Wednesday night. Let your light so shine before men, they may see your good works and glorify your Father, which is in heaven. According to Jesus, this is not something that is forced. He said, let it happen. You can't make that happen, by the way. And you can't let a light shine that you don't possess. And I don't say that for any other reason than to search your own heart. If the struggle is, I can't make any sense of the Christian life, perhaps, and I'm not trying to talk anybody that is saved out of being saved, but perhaps the difference is there's no light at all. You know? I mean, I tried that. I don't know how many of them. I'm not asking for a show of hands, but I tried to be different when I wasn't. I tried to be good when I wasn't. I tried to not drink and drug when I couldn't. I mean, I tried a lot of things without God. And I'm not saying that, you know, we're just, you know, out there on our own and we're just, you know, terrible people and everything like that. But I am saying this. When you get the power of God in and on your life, it'll be different. It'll be absolutely, miraculously, noticeably different. So he said, let your light shine before men. It appears to be something that might be described as the overflow of our lives. When we are growing in the Lord and experiencing the newness of the Christian life, or if we have been saved for many years and the newness is often our experience, it will naturally flow into the other areas of our lives for people to see. Again, we see the result. They may see your good works and glorify your Father which is in heaven. It would do us well to first see if there is any noticeable change in our lives that we can personally see. If we can't see any, we can be sure that others can't see it as well. I remember one time, and I'll finish with this, and I'll read this last paragraph and we'll go. But I remember one time as God was doing a work in my life, and especially in the life of my wife, who was changing a lot faster than me. In fact, if we would have been in a race, she'd have lapped me about 10 times on the first week. But I noticed the change in her life, and it affected my life. And how it affected my life, that the change in her life made her break up with me. So that was serious. That was some serious change. And which changed my life too. You know, my response was a change, but I responded the wrong way. But I said that to say this: the change in her life, I could notice. And then as we as God began to put things together and continue to put things together, and the rest is kind of history. I remember about after we were saved, about 10, maybe 15 years. I think it'll be 30 years this November. But I remember that I thought of an administrator who really poured his life into my life. I never gave it any thought. I thought all, you know, high school administrators were security guards. You know, I thought he was just appointed to me, and he really was. He was appointed to me. I had him all the way through junior high school. That's what they used to call it when I was growing up. And then when I jumped off the bus in ninth grade in high school, he was standing right there. I thought he got transferred just because of me. It wasn't the case, but I thought it was the case. So I had him in 7th, 8th, 9th, 9th, 10th, 11th, 12th. I had him for 7 years. And you caught that. But I had him for 7 years, and I would think if I could just do anything and get away with it, it would have to be because Mr. Shannon doesn't know about it. And he was good at his job, but I was good at mine, you know what I mean? But so I remember one time after I got saved, and I don't really remember whether it was in, you know, reading the Bible in a Sunday school class or in a preaching service, but God put on my heart, you need to go and find him. Go and find him and just tell him thank you. Because I didn't understand what his motive was, what it was all about when he was doing all the things to make my life more miserable than I was already making it. He was just catching me, and that's what made it more miserable. But I remember going, and he was back home. We were already in Florida. And so we went home one Thanksgiving, I think it was, and I took one of my kids, who was about 5 years old. This was a long time ago. And I took her with me, and I found out where he worked. First, I went to my old high school to see if he was there, and they told me he was in another place. If you're like 40 years old or 35 years old, and you go to your old high school and walk through those halls, whew, that's different. And nobody's looking for you, you know. But so I went to the other location, and I pulled up from away from where he was, and he was, you know, sitting out there waiting for the buses to get off, the people get off the buses. And he used to wear this long, it was in late November up there, so it was kind of cold already, and he used to wear this long London fog coat, and it appeared it was the same coat. And I felt sorry for him right away. You need to get paid more. But it was in good shape. But he's just standing there, and he's like this. Looking for the Rickies of the world, you know what I mean? That's what they used to call me. And a stern face like a flint. Looking around like that. And I walked up. I got within 6 feet of him. And, you know, he's just still, I mean, business, man. He's just like looking around. And kids are coming up to him, Mr. Shannon, I was supposed to do this. And bang, he threw off an answer. I'm like, you're not going to get away with that. You know, and he just on and on. So I just stood there and I kind of watched him. Then I walked up to him and he caught a glimpse of me. And our eyes made contact. And like I said, they called me Ricky. He said, Ricky. I said, Mr. Shannon. And I almost couldn't talk. And I put out my hand and I shook his hand and I said, I just wanted to come and say thank you for what you did in my life. And he was in, you're welcome. You know, come on, man, that's 1,000 miles here, bro. Okay. And I said, I wanted to thank you for not giving up on me. And he said, never give up on anybody. Never give up on anybody, Ricky. What are you up to these days? And I said, well, it's interesting because at the time I was in a different ministry, and I was in DJJ, and we were involved in boot camp and kids in the projects and stuff like that. I said, well, I'm really working with kids that are got some pretty serious discipline problems and in trouble with the law and stuff like that. And he looked at me and goes, you ought to be good at it. I thought, no. I don't know what reaction I was looking for, and I think maybe I'm here for me, not for you. But when I walked away, I don't know. I don't really know how to describe the it was just one of those God moments that hopefully and finally, maybe every once in a while, will you realize I just did something God wanted me to do. And God just put his hand on that. And back home, fast forward about a year, I got a phone call from my mom and said, Mr. Shannon passed away. Just retired, I mean, young, relatively, probably in his 60s, late 60s, and I had a heart attack. And the Lord confirmed in my heart, I said, thank you, God, that I finally did something you told me to do. And I don't have to sit here and not and wonder what it would have been like if I'd have done it. Folks, listen. If you have the light, let it shine. Let people see the newness in your life. Because if they don't see that, they don't care what we have to say.
Amen.
They really don't. We're better off, and I don't say this in a mean way or anything, because I've been guilty of the same thing, but we're better off not saying anything.
That's right.
If we're going to say something and then not live it practically. I'm not talking about perfectly. I met a guy at the jail one time who was an employee. And he would say it, and we had this conversation with him. Ronnie's met him as well. He was a former Muslim, and stopped me in the hall one time. He said, one of the reasons I turned to Christ and became a Christian because of the difference that I saw in you guys when you came in here. And I had no idea he was watching anything we were doing. No idea. He said, man, I know the other groups that come in here, and it was a substance abuse thing, and I'm not trying to, it's not an us and them thing. He said, I know the other groups that come in here, and I watch them, and I listen to them, and you guys are completely different than they are. You talk different, you act different, you respond to things different. He said, I'm telling you what, that's what helped me to know that Christianity was real and turn from what I was committed to wholeheartedly to turn to Christ. He today is a member of our church. And so I didn't even know that. I didn't even know it. I wasn't trying to push it or anything like that. I didn't even know it. But what I did know is we had an observer. We had an observer. And folks, everybody's got a couple of them today. You got a couple of observers. They're watching you. Don't get upset about that. That's a good thing. You know? Do what you're supposed to do. Let that light shine. And let them see your good works and glorify God. And that's the best result it can be. Let's go ahead and pray. Father God, I thank you. I thank you that this newness, when you put a new song in our mouth, and God, many shall see it in fear and trust in the Lord. God, thank you that this can be a reality. This should be a reality. I thank you that every person in this room has the same opportunity. God, it's really not based on a whole lot of knowledge. Knowledge helps, no doubt about that. It's not based on intellect. Certainly, that doesn't have anything to do with it. That helps. But God, it's really based on an experience with Jesus Christ. And then the overflow of that experience, that relationship with Christ, that growing, that sanctification process, that learning about the Christian life that people see, no doubt will be a difference in the life that we used to live. And so God, we're no better than that. We're better off, but we're no better than anybody else because of that. But God, we see the result in that. And I pray for every person in this room. First, God, those that don't have a relationship with Christ, that they be saved before it's eternally too late. And those that do, God, that don't think that they can make a difference, that their life is not significant, that their life is not what somebody else might be, and they don't have this tremendous, you know, outstanding testimony. God, one, if we're saved, we have a miraculous testimony regardless of what we've done or not done. But secondly, God, you want to use every person in this room to make a difference in the lives of other people. And I pray that you would help us to be sensitive to that. Maybe it's just to grab some invitation cards and invite people in the most excellent way. Maybe it's just to be a blessing, a kind word, say a prayer for somebody, whether they know it or whether they don't. People are going to see the difference in our lives when there is a difference. And I pray for every person in this room that somebody else will see it and glorify you. But folks, in the quietness of this moment, we're about to be done, and I don't want to rush it, and I certainly know we got to get out of here. But if you've never trusted Christ as your Savior, this morning may be the day that God's speaking to your heart, kind of knocking on your heart's door and asking you to let Him in. You've never asked Jesus Christ to come into your life. Today might be that day. You recognize that you're a sinner. You believe that Jesus Christ died for your sins. And you just want to ask Him to forgive you and invite Christ into your life. If that's your desire, with our heads bowed and eyes still closed, I just want to give you a simple prayer to pray. You can pray it out loud if you want to, or silently in your own heart. Either way, God will save you. Right where you sit, you might want to pray a simple prayer like this. Dear Lord Jesus, I know I'm a sinner. I believe that you died for my sins. Forgive me of my sins. I invite you to come into my life. I receive you as my Savior. Thank you for dying for me. Teach me how to live the Christian life. In Jesus' name, amen. With our heads bowed and eyes still closed, you say, Rick, I just made that decision for the first time. I just want to pray for you. I'm not going to call you out or ask you to stand or anything else. Say, Rick, I just prayed and asked Christ to come into my life for the first time. I want to pray for you. Will you slip your hand up right where you're at so I can pray for you? Don't be embarrassed. Grace, one. Anybody else? Two. Just prayed and asked Christ to come into my life just now. Anybody else? It's the greatest decision you ever made in your entire life. Praise God, He still saves people that want to be saved. Three. Anybody else? I see your hand. Amen. God bless you. Father, thank you. Father, thank you that there's joy in the presence of the angels of God over these who just now invited Christ to come into their life. I pray that the first opportunity they get, come to one of us, we'll talk to them about baptism. God, making that decision public at the end of the church service, perhaps even today at the 10:30 hour. And I pray that you be glorified in their lives. I pray, God, that when we leave this place, we have a more intentional objective to letting our light shine. Bless the 10:30 worship service. In Jesus' name, amen.